Hi, fellow ruminators. Welcome back to another session, Rumination with Andrew. Thank you so much for joining as we are about to discuss a very important topical matter. And hoorah! Last night we had the US presidential elections between Donald Trump and Kamala Harris. And what a match that was, right? It was like they were in a wrestling match and they were actually vying for Americans' attention. And the question is, who won? Because that is what Americans like to think, who won the debates. And for the military-industrial complex, we can say that Kamala Harris won the debates as she actually launched her baits on Trump, who fell for the baits, right? Can you imagine? Trump was baited and he likes to bait people. So it was very interesting that Trump allowed himself to have been baited last night by Kamala Harris, right? The Democratic nominee for the US presidential election, which will be held in November. Now, that is something very interesting, and it was very entertaining to watch. Of course, everything that American does is all about entertainment because the American people like to be entertained. They really don't like thing of substance, and that is what you get. You get what you want. And the media houses, the media outlets, and the politicians, they joined their hands and hearts together to give you what you really wanted, to be the entertainment, real entertainment, someone in a wrestling match. And that is what really happened last night. And who could give the harder punches, the harder verbal punches? Now, we're not talking about physical punches here, right? Maybe I should say a boxing match, right? And a woman now is able to, hurl her fists, right, and her knocks at a man. And Kamala came out strong as she used the art of baiting very well, extremely well. And I thought that she was very well prepared, not on policies, right, not on what she's going to do to improve the lives of Americans, not on what she would do to minimize the wars around the world. And to actually, get rid of the, if you will, of the military-industrial complex, to send them packing out of Washington, the national security state that is running the country, as it were. She did not address these concerns, right? She was more towards looking at Trump's personality, the fact that he is this dictator, as she suggests that he is. He has this Hitlerian disposition, and he is the existential threat to America's democracy. Now, that is what we're being told, and Americans have been fed with that diet for such a long time that it's very difficult at this point in time to tell them that that is a diet that is not going to be good for their political health or political well-being, right? Because it's not true. We can say that the military-industrial complex is, in fact, Hitlerian, it's a dictator, and it is the greatest existential threat to America's democracy. But people think they believe what they see on the mainstream media, and they are the fact checkers, and they will check all what is factual from what is not factual. So, which and the media houses, the media outlets in America, the US media outlets are controlled, are run by the US military industrial complex. Right? They run the show by the national security state, because that's what America really is right now, a national security state. And for that reason, they're talking about who is an existential threat. And throughout the Cold War, we have been hearing that. So it was first communism was the existential threat, Russia and the Soviet Union, right? They were the existential threats. And Americans believed every word for the most part that, came from the mouths of their believable and incredible politicians, and they actually fell for the bait. Then, fast forward after the Cold War, we have now the war on terror, effectuated by Bush, right? That was the existential threat to the Arabs. Muslims were the existential threat to America's democracy, their freedoms, because the Arabs and Muslims hated their freedoms as George W. Bush so explicitly articulated during his presidency. after 9/11 took place. Now, that's something that we have to explore. And after the war on terror, then we have, of course, Trump, right? The Trump era started in 2016. And then he became the major threat. He and his group, the MAGA group, or the MAGA group, Make America Great Again. You know, Americans, actually now you have domestic terrorists, right? So it's not only foreign terrorists through, you know, in the form of the Muslim that you have, but you also have the MAGA group, the Make America Great Again group, that also represents an existential threat to America's democracy. And I think very soon the immigrants are going to be a major threat to America's democracy, depending on who you talk to, right? If you talk to the Democrats, they are great people, right? If you talk to the Republicans, the immigrants are the greatest threat to America's democracy. And that is why Trump reined in on illegal immigrants last night. And it was very interesting what he said about the Haitians and the fact that they are dog-consuming, pet-consuming immigrants. Something very interesting to have beheld. It's interesting, too, that Kamala did not do much to debunk, you know, his analysis. She was, you know, nodding. She was actually, you know, through her body language, suggesting that that is not true. Right. So she was, you know, so she gave that sort of head movement to suggest, no, that is not true. However, right, having said that, she really did not do anything to debunk that sort of theory. Right. There was not much said. And she could have come with some greater statistics. You know, Trump could have, but since we say that he is a liar, and the public knows him to be a guy who is a pathological liar, and the Democratic Party speaks the truth. So I think that Kamala should have come with more statistics based on the evidence or the lack thereof. And I don't think that she came up with that. As I suggested before, I think it was almost just the debates could be summarized, as it were, as just a debate based on personality, where they're launching attacks on each other's personalities and how they govern, you know, in their own personal way of governing or governance. I think that that was what it was all about. It was not about substantive policy issues and how they are going to move the American people along. Kamala is using this catchphrase now that we're not going back. And this is probably one of her favorite catchphrases. We are not going back. Going back to what? What? When you are suggesting that we're not going back to what, Kamala? And this is something that is a little frightening. I don't think Americans understand that in that sort of catchphrase, so much is at stake. Because I think the military-industrial complex is sending Americans this message that we're not going back to this world of freedom or limited wars. It is a war era. We have found ourselves enmeshed in a war game that we're not going to come out of. So anybody who thinks that they're going to go back to an era in which they have peace and quietude in America is not in many wars. But I know, when can we ever remember? Is there a time when America was not involved in wars? But we know that they're involved in multiple wars. That's the problem right now. These are multiple and they're big wars, right? We had the war against Afghanistan, then Iraq, Syria, you know, Yemen, right? And the list is extensive, Libya, and now Russia and Israel, right? And Palestine. So these are huge wars, and they're multiple wars, and they're affecting America's economy, and not only their economy, psychological, social, and other forms of health and well-being, right? When we talk about wars, we're talking about soldiers being sent to war, right? And soldiers are killed, and their family members have to deal with that. They're injured, and when they come home, they suffer from a lot of post-traumatic disorders, which affect the society. Some of the mass shootings that we're seeing in America are coming as a result, or happening as a result, of people who are suffering, ex-soldiers who are suffering from post-traumatic mental disorder. Some of them are and they do not have any means of controlling their emotions. These are some of the effects of wars. So war is not just about going to a foreign country. It's also what impact, what effect will it have on the country that is propagating that war? And in many cases, the United States, through its military-industrial complex, propagates wars because it's a war machine. The United States is, in fact, a war machine. And that is what Kamala Harris and, to a lesser extent, Donald Trump were defending last night in the US presidential debates. Now, let me say something very, very clear here. Kamala Harris is definitely a war hawk. And the people who are supporting her, are supporting that. She's very clear on that, right? No bones about that. And that's why she keeps on talking about respecting the military. And no one's suggesting that we should not respect the military, because the military is there to protect Americans from, whatever threat might be out there. The fact of the matter is that there is no real threat. The threats are being manufactured. And after they've been manufactured, then they are being exaggerated on the US media. And the people say, well, yeah, these people are going to attack us and they're going to destroy your country. But if you look behind the scenes, and particularly if you look at history and see how history has flown, then you will see that, or, has flowed, I should say, the ebbs and the flows of history, right? You will see that, America has always initiated the wars that are being waged around the world. And nothing is different in our time, in our era at the moment. Nothing is different. It continues, right? A vida continua, right? That is what is happening. And we've got to really make the connections with history here. And many of us have not really sought to delve into history. And many of us also don't even read about politics and understand political history and the machinations, the political machinations that are or have been evident and have played a very pivotal role in the shaping of the modern political landscape. And we've got to really delve in these things. We've got to really wake up, because a lot of times we find ourselves so tethered to the television and the media that we find that is the perspective we have. And many of us, when we talk, we're not coming with anything that is deep, that is critical, right? And something that we can chew on mentally so that we can make right decisions. Because this election is going to be one of the most consequential elections of the United States of America. Right? Now, Donald Trump, even though he's not far away from representing the military-industrial complex, but he is less enthusiastic about their warfare, whether we like it or not. And I think every time he speaks, and or even his time in office, we can see that he's not an enthusiastic warmonger. Donald Trump's personality is that he should be respected, and he will force him to respect him. And he wants America's name to be respected. From that purpose, he loves the military-industrial complex, because if you speak against him, if you speak against America's interest, then he can stand up and then he can send the military over and he can show you who is in charge, who is the boss in the room. That he likes. But I don't think that he likes to go around the world and wage unnecessary wars. I don't think he loves that. And I think the Democratic Party, which was the party of freedom and the party of civil rights, they are more enthusiastic about waging wars around the world. And they are so much blood hungry, something that we have to understand. And those of you who are planning to vote for the Democratic Party, that's what you're voting for. Now, you have fallen for the bait when they tell you that Trump is this existential threat, right? And some of you have told me that, the fact that he's going back to the presidency, he's power hungry, and he might be power hungry, but you have to look at policies. You've got to look closely at who is the one who is going to kill and murder innocent citizens around the world, because it's going to affect you and it's going to affect your children and your children's children for generations to come. Well, I think we have become benumb. We have become desensitized, as it were, to wars, that we think it's just another day. But you must understand that millions of people around the world are displaced, right? Their lives have been ravaged. Their bodies have been dismembered. And we must understand that these are horrific crimes. These are crimes against humanity. And if you know, if you have the knowledge that your party is promoting warfare and you continue to support them, it means they're therefore indirectly you're supporting their bloodthirsty disposition. You are. There's no way around saying that. So many of you who are going to vote for the Democratic Party, you have your right to vote for the Democratic Party. But you must understand that when you do that, you're casting a vote for vicious wars around the world. The Republican Party does it too. And under Trump, we saw where he was also the war in Syria and other wars that he actually continued after Obama. But he was not so much starting the war. We must say that the Democratic Party, when they came back into power in 2021, Biden could not even have sat in the in his chair comfortably before he started another war. It was the war with Russia. And based on investigative analysis coming from investigative journalists who suggest that there could have been a peace agreement, but Biden did not want a peace agreement with Putin. He walked away from a peace agreement. He wanted war because the quest of the United States is to control that area, and they have to control Russia. Right? They have to control Russia. So they had to have begun a war with Russia. And Putin wouldn't want the war because he knew that it was going to weaken Russia. Wars weaken country. But the United States can do it because the United States has the most powerful military in the history of humanity. Right? Because the United States invests more in its military than all the developed nations combined, than all of the military states and nations combined. So nobody really can compete with US military. But what we're talking here is not just the military, it's the whole psychology of militarism and imperialism. That's what we're talking about. Many Americans think that Americans are the US military is there to defend them, but militarism is not seeking to defend you. Militarism is seeking to control you, to control foreign countries and their peoples, and also to control American citizens on the soil. That is what you have to grasp. And I don't think you have grasped that when they talk about security. You think that they're out there fighting to protect the mainland, right? The homeland. But they're not doing that, right? They are actually trying to control you and to take away your freedoms. And that is why the Constitution is so much now being put in second place. And it's being sidestepped because it is not their intention to promote the values, the principles outlined in the United States Constitution. And that's why you're losing your free speech. Right? And also to protest and all of these things, we find that these rights are being restricted in America as the days go by. And Americans are not taking these things seriously or seriously enough. You've got to read more about militarism and imperialism that, Chalmers Johnson has aptly suggested or has aptly described as Siamese twins. Militarism and imperialism are Siamese twins. Now, if you open up the papers this morning, you hear, I see in the New York Times, they have who won the debates. That's the question being asked, and a very important question. A sharp Harris rattled Trump, and that is what the New York Times is saying. Let me see if I could show you, the papers for you to see what I'm actually reading from. So we have here, let's go to the New York Times, and This is commentators, even Republicans, concluded that Kamala Harris had succeeded in provoking Donald Trump into veering off message, right? So she provoked him. And you could see that he was rattled, you know, when he said to her, it's my turn and you need to shut up. And, you know, he didn't say shut up, but he said almost like you need to stop talking. And he was, you know, a bit rattled and angered at her baits, the fact that he perhaps learned, you know, that he was not really on the right track. So the New York Times reports here, in the first and perhaps only presidential debate between Vice President Kamala Harris and former President Donald J. Trump, the two candidates verbally sparred in often deeply personal terms, with policy arguments largely being overshadowed by fiery exchanges over character and crowd size. So even the New York Times is suggesting that this debate was not about policy arguments or talking about, you know, substantive matters that would be of concern to the American people. It was more about, you know, it was overshadowed by fiery exchanges over character and crowd size. And that is to tell you, and it is an indicator, an indication of the Americans and Americans on the whole, their infantile sort of mentality. Because if you had a more educated citizenry, one who understands the issues, they would have been forced to talk about the issues. But you see, you know, the president passing through, the vice president rather, or the former president passing through their states and their constituency, and people are shouting and behaving like these people are kings. Right? There's no difference. What you see when they're in their presidential, what you call it, motorcade, whatever you want to call it. Right? And you see these people outside, it's almost like they're monarchs. That's exactly what you see when you look at England and you see the Queen passing and the people are cheering, right? These people should not be people that you're doing that to, because you have crowned them, you have coronated them as the reigning monarchs over your lives. And you think that you are obligated to voting for them. And that is why Black people over the years have thought that Democrats can do nothing. They can do them no harm. They're going to vote for the Democrats. Right? Because Democrats can do them no harm. Because they don't think. How can you vote for a party that is going abroad and killing people of color? You say that you're a person of color. And you have absolutely no regards for that. You don't think about that. I'm going to vote for them because guess what? I'm not voting for Donald Trump. What sort of argument is that? Are you looking at the fact that perhaps under Donald Trump, even though Donald Trump can be erratic, but we can't predict what he's going to do or not do. But at least we know that during his presidency, he had not launched a lot of wars around the world. And I'm not for Donald Trump. But we have to look at issues. We have to look at issues. And for many times I've come on this platform, I've told you that during slavery in America, during the civil rights, not the civil rights, but the Civil War, it was not that Abraham Lincoln was anti-slavery, because he really did not see anything wrong with slavery in the South as it existed. What he did not want was it for it to have been expanded. So, but Black people, it was in their interest to have it totally eliminated, to have slavery totally eradicated, right? But the free Blacks, they knew that they had to go with the Republican Party at the time, because at least the Republican Party, even though not flawless, and had a lot of flaws. They had a lot of flaws. Right? But they had to go with the lesser, what you call the lesser of the two evils. Because the Democratic Party, right, was unrepentant in its quest to have slavery. It was not even up for discussion because slavery was so profitable. The same thing is happening now. That wars are profitable, the war machinery is profitable. And Black people are behind that war that is enslaving hundreds of thousands of people around the world. And you're going to tell me that because of Donald Trump, you are going to vote for a party that is clear, that is unrepentant, that is not even acting, that it is pro war and it is pro the killing of innocent lives around the world. Now, what is in that brain? What are you thinking? Are you reflecting on the history and understand that you have political shifts and you cannot look at personality? You have to look at the issues. The issues have to be properly examined. And I think that a lot of Black people, a lot of people of color are not interested in doing that. They're more interested in looking at the cultural wars about who is transgender, that we have to fight for equal rights and social justice. Do you think the military industrial complex is interested in social justice and equal rights? It's not. It's only using those words to bait you. And you have been baited, like Donald Trump. So when you're laughing at Donald Trump, you yourself are Donald Trump because you have been baited. You have allowed yourself to have been baited. Kamala Harris, and she is going to be the first, if she wins the election, that is, she's going to be the first South Asian and first Black and woman to have gone to the Oval Office. What is that? What does that even mean? Do you think people care when they're dying? If the person is Black or woman or South Asian or Black or Jamaican, they don't care. We have to examine carefully the policies, which many people are not doing. They're more looking at personalities. And I'm happy that the New York Times, of all the papers, and that paper too represents national security state and the military industrial complex, but they have said it very well here that the whole debate lacked substantive, it did not present substantive policies that would push the American economy along. And it was more about personality and character and crowd size. Now, the New York Times continues to say political pundits, analysts, and commentators noted that Mr. Trump had often found himself on the defensive on issues such as abortion, while showing allowing himself rather to be baited by Mrs. Harris or Miss Harris and veering off message. The vice president belittled the attendance at tr Mr. Trump's rallies and suggested that American military leaders view him as a disgrace. And Mr. Trump often responded angrily, declaring that she had no policies of her own and was the worst vice president in the history of our country. I don't think anything was wrong with that. They were debating, and she was saying that he was disgraceful. So I think that, I thought it was effective from his part to say that she is, in fact, if you look at the statistics, she is, in fact, not a favorable vice president. And she perhaps, as he suggested, as he intimated, one of the least famous or favorable, I should say, vice president in America's history, in American history. It is true, right? It is true. So there's nothing wrong. I thought it was an effective punch that he had on her. And I'm not pro Trump again, but we're talking about debates here. And she said her thing about, he being disgraceful and being a threat and being dictator. So he had to come up with other things. I just thought that he too could have presented more, evidence-based factual information about immigration, because immigration is a sore point in the United States. And if he had prepared himself well, I think Trump underestimated Kamala Harris. And the Kamala Harris that he saw on the stage was not the one that, but I think he should know that she would have Hillary Clinton, she would have made her mistake on her debates with him. She would have had people like the Obamas who would have really helped her in her presentation and delivery of the information. He should have known that, or at least his advisors should have known that. I don't know if Trump was tired. He could. He's an old man. He's 78 years old. So he might have prepared, but was just not up to that moment. Right. And also, I think he had this overconfidence because he had really knocked Joe Biden out in the first debates held in May, that he thought that, perhaps this is nothing and he's going to do the same thing for with Kamala. What was interesting, you don't know if the two are playing games here too, because I was very shocked that Donald Trump did not say much about Kamala's performance, her record that she had. That's a legal, her legal career, in her legal career as an attorney general and also district attorney. I was shocked because there's a lot to talk about. There's a lot that he could have unpacked there before the audience that would have shamed her in terms of her legal record and what she did and did not do to improve the lives of, Black people or people of color, and the social justice that she's so much tethered to and she talks about, and this equal society of which she is desirous. There's so much that he could have unpacked, but he didn't unpack those things, which is something I found quite weird. Why wouldn't you have gone for her there? And why didn't his advisors give him real data, real statistics? Because Trump has a fantastic memory. Give him his credit. He has a fantastic memory that he could have memorized those statistics and he could have just dished them out. And I'm sure that Kamala would find it very difficult to really debunk. But he did not do any of that. He just talked about some stupid nonsense about immigrants eating pets, right? And other things that were not, and of course, her personality traits and stuff like that. She's the most unfavorable vice president in the history of the United States. So they're saying it, the New York Times is saying Harris baited him into going off topic or doubling down on his most unpopular positions. She cleared the bar in terms of telling her personal story, going deep enough on policy. I don't know if she went deep, but also showing she has the chops to go toe to toe with anyone, right? Harris started somewhat hesitatingly, perhaps because Trump's attacking style and factless presentation are quite different from the courtroom or the Senate floor, right? And Trump is good on the political with the political debates. He's excellent, right? Let's give him his props here. But it comes on to political debates because it's not a court, as they're suggesting here, where you have to go with the facts and the evidence before you can speak, right? Or before you can speak compellingly, because you're talking about the law here. With politics, you can say anything and your base, is listening, and you hope that you will have gotten some knock. It's almost like being in a boxing match, as it were. Now, we have here in the political, right, the political newspaper, they're asking the same question, who won the debate? But here they're suggesting that the world can now see Kamala Harris in its most powerful job, right? So the world is envisioning Kamala Harris. If one of Donald Trump's goals during tonight's debate was to show that Kamala Harris would be a weak world leader, he failed. Right, he failed. I didn't see her as a strong world leader either. Right, so I neither saw her as a strong world leader nor as a weak one either. I know that she's not the one running the show if she should win the elections. So I know that she has, but for the optics, I understand what they're suggesting here. She managed, after all, to hold her own against him while navigating topics unusually tricky for a Biden administration official, such as the chaotic US military withdrawal from Afghanistan and the politically dicey Israel-Hamas war. On the second, Harris repeatedly stressed the need for a two-state solution, for instance, showing her support for Palestinians while also insisting she'll defend Israel. I found Trump's attack on her, as someone who hates Israel and Jews, I found that very, very stupid. Why would he even say that? She's married to a Jew, right? And we know that, as she suggested, and I'm sure that I hope you have picked it up, she said her words that she has been supporting Israel from her life, from the beginning. And I think that the Jews were particularly behind Kamala's success in California. her being a district attorney and then the attorney general of California. I think that they were behind her, and they are behind her, and they were behind her in her quest for the Senate to have become a senator, which she won in 2016. Was it 2016, 2017, thereabout, right? She went to the Senate, and they are behind her now as vice president. And her husband is Jew, and I did tell you on a form in a former video that her husband, Doug Emhoff, is Biden's unofficial advisor on anti-Semitism. So there is no way that Trump, he has no evidence, and it is foolhardy, it was foolhardy for him to have suggested that she hates Jews or she hates the Jewish people or Israel. That was nonsense, because we know that Kamala is a pro-Israel candidate. Both are, both Trump, make no bones about it. Make no bones about it. Both Trump and Harris are pro-Israel supporters, and they will defend Israel at any cost, even if it means Americans' lives and the loss of the economy, the loss of your livelihoods. You've got to understand that. Trump was not critical of Israel during the debates, right? What he wanted to do last night during the debates was to cement his advocacy and his passion for defending Israel more than Kamala's, right? In other words, let me put it simply. Both of them, both Harris and Trump, wanted to cement themselves in the Americans, you know, public, in the American public, or to the American public, as who is going to be the more fascistic presidents in terms of defending Israel as a nation. Right? It was not about defending the rights of both the Israelis and the Palestinians. It's about defending. Well, she said that she wanted a two-state solution and she wanted a ceasefire and all of that sort of thing. But to say one thing and to do what they're doing are distinct. And people need to understand that. They tend to say, but be fair to her because she did say that. Your actions are what speak, not what the words that you articulate. Your actions are what you have to judge or what you should judge a person by, not from what the person has said. I can say that I want to become a doctor, but if I'm not doing the subjects and I'm not studying enough and I'm not trying to, you know, read upon science and stuff like that, I'm not going to become a doctor. But I might be passionate about, you know, the medical world. But if I'm not doing the things that will lead me to becoming a doctor, then more than likely I won't. And based on what we're seeing now with Kamala, and the huge amount of machinery and military weapons and monies that have been sent to Israel, we know that Kamala is not seriously thinking about a two-state solution. She could not be seriously thinking about a two-state solution. That is evidently clear. So when, but Trump too is not doing the same thing, and he has no plans for Israel. He has not articulated, he did not articulate just last night in the debate, any sort of plan for Israel. Right? Now, some Trump critics had argued prior to the shutdown that he was a stand-in for the autocrats that future President Harris may counter, the Vladimir Putins and the Xi Jinpings of the world. Now, you know, Trump, you know, was acting as if he, you know, had these this great sort of rapport, or these people, these autocrats in the world, you know, are fearful of him, are afraid of him. But you know what he represents, what Trump, nobody's is afraid of Trump. Trump is just a 78-year-old man, right? And I don't think Trump can fight at this, you know, I don't think he can defend himself physically in any war, right? But the fact is that he knows that he has the backative, the support of the military industrial complex. So when they talk about being afraid of, they're not talking about themselves. Kamala is only 5'4". She's a woman. Who can she fight? Right? What they're talking about is who the military, this formidable military apparatus that the United States has actually built up over the years. And that is what is supporting them. So make no bones about it. Don't be fooled by the fact that you think it's Trump is, you know, the leaders are afraid of Trump because Trump is Trump. Trump is Trump because he knows that he has the backing of the national security state. That's the US national security state. So that is interesting. And I found it very, the whole debate very interesting last night. And what was very disappointing, and I just have said it, I hope that I've said it, that the American people have lost, right? The American people have lost while Harris has won. Trump has lost the debate, right? As a person. But the American people, for the most part, they're the ones who have lost because there was nothing on the in the debates about how the intractable problems that bedevil America right now will be solved. There are just some broad policy proposals that were suggested, that were recommended, but there were no specifics into how they are going to do it, given that the United States at the moment is committed to launching its wars and its war efforts. I don't see how they are going to plow billions of dollars into solving the critical problems and to building up America's infrastructure. I was listening to Clayton last night on Redacted. And he was talking about his hometown in Philadelphia. And when he goes back there, which he does go back there frequently, because I think Clayton lives in Clayton Morris, that is, of Redacted. He lives in New Jersey. So he does go back to visit, and maybe his family members are there. And he says that the decline, the urban, rot that he sees in Philadelphia is something that is disturbing. And the number of people in gangs and also that are addicted to drugs. So how is America going to clean up its cities? And most of these cities are actually, run by the Democrats. Chicago, Philadelphia, where you have lots of people of color, blacks and Latinos, as they like to say, they're people of color. As if the so-called white people are colorless. But that is another conversation. We don't want to get into that conversation this morning. But the fact of the matter is that where we are at right now should be uncomfortable for most Americans to know that the president of what you call the free world cannot, neither the incumbent government nor the opposition can articulate, can present substantive issues that will be compelling to Americans, that Americans can see yes or can imbibe some amount of hope and change and joy as Kamala desires. Because nothing that they said last night was joyful. Nothing that they said last night was to make America great again. Nothing they said last night was deemed to be something of change and hope. Nothing, absolutely nothing. Right? It was just about launching character attacks and counterattacks. And also, speculating about who is going to be the better of the two presidents, who would make a better president. It was empty. It was an empty debate. It was an empty debate. And for that reason, the American people have lost. While these two candidates, whether you like it or not, they're making millions of dollars. Millions of dollars. While many Americans are living in abject poverty and are indebted to the T. And if the dollar should lose its reserve currencies, global reserve currency status tomorrow, many Americans are going to find out that they are going to be in a very precarious situation, a situation of which they had not even dreamt. Because they think that they're living in a la-la land, and somehow the US military is there to protect them and to protect the economy of America and to show the world that Americans are important and that they're special people. But they're not doing that. They're not doing that. That is not their quest. Their quest is to achieve, and I've told you before on many occasions that their only quest is to achieve full spectrum dominance. And full spectrum dominance means control, dominance, hegemony. And that's what we're seeing in Palestine, in Gaza, in Syria, in Yemen, in Libya, in Iraq, in Afghanistan, in all over the world. We have been seeing what full spectrum dominance mean. Right? It doesn't mean that it is going to be nice. It doesn't mean that it is going to support democracy. It doesn't mean that it is going to fix your economy. It doesn't mean that it wants it to fight for social justice, because something that dominates is not really supporting democracy, is not supporting equality, does not see you on equal footing with them. They see you as their inferiors, and that is why they're making you poorer, because the poorer you get, then the more you can be controlled. And Americans are fast becoming an impoverished set of people. It's not yet there because of the years of the building of that wealth. So it takes some time for you to see that. Look here. Look, wake up. This is not the country that we think we are living in. And it is there, grossly indebted to other countries from which it receives free lunch. I'm happy that Professor Hudson, that's Michael Hudson, came up with that free lunch theory. That Americans receive a free lunch because of what the third and the global South citizens have to go through, right? They have to pay you these high interest rates and the economic policies, the austerity that the global South has to endure gives Americans free lunch. So don't think that there's something special about the wealth that is in America. Oftentimes it is stolen wealth. It is wealth that you have received through the killing and the slaughtering, not only of physical lives, but the killing and the ravaging and the plundering and the pillaging of people's economy to have you enjoy a certain level of comfort. So don't think now that this is going to be forever. It's not going to last forever, because while innocent people out there are dying and they're suffering at your expense, the blood is going to be on your shoulder, and you and your children and your children's children will have to pay the consequence or the consequences for the, what should I say now, unwise decisions that your political leaders have made. Thank you so much for joining. I hope that you like and you share and you subscribe. Remember now that you need to hit the subscription button, and also leave a comment, because the comment helps to tell the algorithms that you actually are interacting with the video, and they will share it with as many people as possible. So comment on the video, say something, and so that I can hear your responses of what you are thinking. Thank you so much for joining. See you in another one. Adios.